So as promised, I'll be lecturing about jurisdiction and remedies. Original and exclusive jurisdiction of the labor arbiter. We have an enumeration here of the original and exclusive jurisdiction of the labor arbiters. First is unfair labor practice cases. 2, termination disputes. 3, money claims of workers exceeding 5,000 pesos. 4, money claims of workers regardless of amount if there is a prayer for reinstatement. 5, disputes pertaining to legality of strikes and lockouts. 6, claims for damages arising from employer-employee relations. 7, wage distortion disputes in unorganized establishments. Money claims of overseas Filipino workers. Other claims arising from employer-employee relations, except claims for employees' compensation, social security, PhilHealth, and maternity benefits. Remember that the labor arbiter, even the NLRC, can acquire jurisdiction only when the claim has a reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. A claim is said to have a reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship if the principal relief sought can be resolved only by reference to the Labor Code of the Philippines or other labor laws and not by general civil law. Unfair labor practice cases. Aside from Article 224, Article 258 of the Labor Code of the Philippines expressly provides that the civil aspects of all cases involving unfair labor practices, which may include claims for actual, moral, exemplary, or other forms of damages, attorney's fees, and other affirmative relief, shall be under the jurisdiction of the labor arbiters. Termination disputes. Jurisdiction of labor arbiters over termination disputes does not cover 1. Dismissal of corporate officers. And 2. Dismissal of employees that calls for interpretation or implementation of the CBA or company personnel policies. With regard to dismissal of corporate officers refer to the president, vice president, secretary, treasurer, and other officers created by charter, bylaws, or by the board of directors. Dismissal of corporate officers is not a labor dispute. This is an intracorporate dispute or controversy. Hence, this is beyond the jurisdiction of the labor arbiters. The jurisdiction falls under the designated regional trial court. Dismissal that calls for interpretation of CBA or personnel policies. Termination disputes arising from interpretation or implementation of the CBA or company personnel policies do not fall under the jurisdiction of the labor arbiters. Remember the delineation of jurisdiction over termination disputes. 1. If the issue pertains to interpretation or implementation of the CBA or company personnel policy, then the termination dispute is cognizable by the voluntary arbitrators. 2. If the issue does not involve interpretation or implementation of the CBA or personnel policies, then the termination dispute is cognizable by the labor arbiter. Money claims of employees. To fall within the jurisdiction of the labor arbiter, the money claim should have a reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. If the money claim has a reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship, the jurisdiction of labor arbiters will depend upon the prayer in the complaint. 1. If the complaint prays for reinstatement, the labor arbiter's jurisdiction regardless of the amount involved. 2. If the complaint does not pray for reinstatement, the jurisdiction will be determined by the amount involved. If the amount is more than 5,000 pesos, then the labor arbiter has jurisdiction. On the other hand, for 5,000 pesos and below, the labor arbiter has no jurisdiction. The jurisdiction falls under the DOLE Regional Director under Article 129 of the Labor Code. Here are some examples of money claims with reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. 1. A complaint for illegal deduction on retirement benefit. 2. A complaint for unpaid notarial fees filed by a lawyer employee. 3. A complaint for unpaid attorney's fees filed by a lawyer employee. How about this one? Money claims of corporate officers. Apply the reasonable causal connection doctrine. If the money claim pertains to perquisites of the corporate position, then the labor arbiter has no jurisdiction because there is no reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. If the money claim pertains to the corporate officer's compensation or benefits as an employee, then the labor arbiters have jurisdiction because of its reasonable causal connection with the employer-employee relationship. How about money claims of employers? Also apply the reasonable causal connection doctrine. Here are examples of money claims of employers without reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. 1. A complaint filed by an employer against an employee for a sum of money arising from a loan. This is because it involves a debtor-creditor relationship rather than employer-employee relationship. 2. A complaint by an employer against an employee for recovery of car acquired under the car loan policy of the company or the payment of its market value. This is not a labor dispute. It is rather a civil dispute because it does not involve employer-employee relationship but debtor-creditor relationship. 3. A complaint filed by a security agency against its principal for separation pay of its security guards. Here, there's no employer-employee relationship between the security agency and its security guards on the one hand and the principal on the other hand. 4. A counterclaim filed by an employer for non-payment of stock subscription. This has no reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. How about money claims of migrant workers? Refer to Section 10 of the Migrant Workers Act. Labor arbiters have original and exclusive jurisdiction over claims of migrant workers arising from employer-employee relationship. Claims for damages. Apply also the reasonable causal connection doctrine. Here are examples of claims for damages that do not have reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. 1. A complaint for damages filed by an employee because of slanderous remarks of an officer of the corporation. This has no reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship because the claim arises from tort, which falls under the realm of civil law. 2. A complaint for damages filed by an employee based on malicious prosecution has no reasonable causal connection with the relations of the parties as employer and employee. Hence, this is beyond the jurisdiction of the labor arbiters. 3. A claim for damages by an employer against an employee for breach of contract of employment. This falls within the realm of civil law. Therefore, it has no reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. 4. A complaint for damages filed by an employer against this employee for breach of training agreement. This falls within the realm of civil law and therefore has no reasonable causal connection with employer-employee relationship. Wage distortion disputes. Wage distortion disputes will fall under the jurisdiction of the labor arbiter only when the establishment is unorganized. How about claims against international organizations? Labor arbiters do not have jurisdiction over disputes between an international organization and its employees because international organizations enjoy diplomatic immunity. Hence, they are beyond the jurisdiction of the courts or local agencies of the Philippine government. The term international organization is generally used to describe an organization set up by agreement between two or more states. Some examples of these organizations are the International Rice Research Institute, International Catholic Migration Commission, Southeast Asian Fisheries Development Center, and Asian Development Bank. The reason for granting immunity to international organizations is to shield them from political pressure or control by the host country to ensure the unhampered performance of their functions. Employees are not without recourse because each organization has a procedure for settlement of disputes. Note the cases that fall beyond the jurisdiction of labor arbiters. 1. Claims for employment compensation benefits. 2. Claims for social security system benefits. 3. Claims for PhilHealth benefits. 4. Claims for unpaid maternity leave salary differentials. 5. Pure money claims not exceeding 5,000 pesos filed by employees already separated from the company. And 6. Disputes arising from interpretation or implementation of the CBA or company personnel policies. Let's now go to remedies. What's the remedy from the adverse decision on the merits rendered by the labor arbiter? This is an appeal to the National Labor Relations Commission. Would a motion for reconsideration be allowed? Motion for reconsideration, including certain motions such as motion for new trial or a petition for relief from judgment, are prohibited pleadings. some things to remember with regard to decisions of labor arbiters. With regard to a decision of the labor arbiter that orders reinstatement, this is immediately executory pending appeal. Article 229. The employer must comply with the reinstatement order with or without a writ of execution. If the employer does not voluntarily comply with the reinstatement order, the labor arbiter shall immediately issue a writ of execution. Note the manner of compliance regarding reinstatement. Physical reinstatement or payroll reinstatement. What's the right of choice when dictating the manner of the compliance of the reinstatement order? It is the employer alone who has the right to choose on whether the employee should be physically reinstated or merely reinstated on payroll. Neither the labor arbiter nor the NLRC can exercise this option on behalf of the employer. Posting of a bond is not a substitute for reinstatement. Compliance with the reinstatement aspect of the labor arbiter's decision during the pendency of the appeal cannot be stayed by posting a bond. There's a requirement of a report. The employer should submit to the labor arbiter a report of compliance with the reinstatement order within 10 calendar days from receipt of the decision. What would be the effect if the reinstatement order is reversed on appeal? 1. If the reinstatement order was implemented, whether by physical or by payroll reinstatement, the employer can put an end to such reinstatement once the judgment on appeal becomes final and executory. 2. If the reinstatement order was not implemented because the employee refused to be reinstated without valid reason, the employer is not liable to pay reinstatement salaries. 3. If the reinstatement order was not implemented because the employer failed or refused to reinstate the employee without valid reason, the employer, this time, is liable to pay the reinstatement salaries of the employee, reckoned from the date when the employer, through counsel, received the labor arbiter's decision until finality of the judgment of the NLRC. Note that there are valid reasons for non-compliance with the reinstatement order. 1. Unjustified refusal on the part of the employee to be reinstated. 2. Latches. If the employee did not do anything to compel the employer to reinstate him during the pendency of the appeal, despite the readiness and willingness of the employer to comply, the employer is not liable to pay any reinstatement salary because the employee is deemed to have forfeited his right to reinstatement through latches. Note the test. 1. The order of reinstatement was not complied with prior to reversal on appeal. And 2. The non-compliance was not due to the employer's unjustified act or omission. 3rd in the enumeration is supervening events. When supervening events render the compliance with the reinstatement order impossible, the employer is not liable to pay any reinstatement salary after the occurrence of the supervening event. 4. Corporate rehabilitation. If the corporation was placed under rehabilitation receivership, it is not liable to pay any reinstatement salary during the pendency of the appeal. Even if the corporate rehabilitation has been terminated, still the employee will not be entitled to reinstatement salary because the peculiar nature of corporate rehabilitation has rendered it impossible for the company to comply with the reinstatement order pending appeal. Salaries received while on payroll reinstatement is not refundable. Reinstatement pending appeal is proper only when the decision of the labor arbiter orders reinstatement. The obligation to reinstate pending appeal exists only when the decision of the labor arbiter expressly orders reinstatement. Therefore, if the decision of the labor arbiter did not order reinstatement, despite his finding that the employee was illegally dismissed, the NLRC, in resolving the appeal, cannot order payment of reinstatement salaries. If the decision of the labor arbiter merely awarded separation pay in lieu of reinstatement, the NLRC on appeal cannot award reinstatement salaries if it reverses the labor arbiter's decision. Let's now go to the adjudicatory power of the regional director. The DOLE regional director is empowered to hear and decide pure money claims not exceeding 5,000 pesos filed by employees who have already been separated from service and who do not seek reinstatement anymore. Note the conditions for the exercise of this adjudicatory power of the regional director. 1. A complaint has been filed by an employee whose employment has already been terminated. 2. The complaint pertains to pure money claims not exceeding 5,000 pesos per complainant. And 3. The complaint does not pray for reinstatement. If the foregoing requisites are not complied with, the case will fall within the jurisdiction of the labor arbiters. What's the remedy from orders issued in the exercise of the adjudicatory power? Decisions or orders of the DOLE Regional Director in the exercise of his adjudicatory power under Article 129 of the Labor Code are appealable to the National Labor Relations Commission within 5 calendar days from receipt of the decision or order. National Labor Relations Commission. On the original and exclusive jurisdiction of the NLRC, note the following. 1. Labor disputes certified to it by the Secretary of the Department of Labor and Employment under Article 278G of the Labor Code of the Philippines. 2. Injunction cases under Articles 225 and 279 of the Labor Code of the Philippines. The appellate jurisdiction of the NLRC. 1. Cases decided by the labor arbiter. 2. Cases decided by the DOLE Regional Director under Article 129 of the Labor Code of the Philippines. Exclusive appellate jurisdiction of the NLRC. Cases decided by the labor arbiter. Cases decided by the DOLE Regional Director under Article 129 of the Labor Code of the Philippines. What would be the period to appeal? It would be 10 calendar days if we're talking about decisions rendered by the labor arbiter. On the other hand, it will be 5 calendar days if we're referring to decisions or orders rendered by the DOLE Regional Director in the exercise of the adjudicatory power under Article 129 of the Labor Code. 5 calendar days also for orders of contempt issued by the labor arbiter. If the last day of filing falls on a Saturday, Sunday, or holiday, the appeal can be filed on the next working day. Note the reckoning period. The reglementary period to appeal is reckoned not from date of the receipt of the decision by the party, but from the date of receipt by the principal counsel or representative on record. The period to appeal is not extendable. If the appeal was filed beyond the reglementary period, the judgment becomes final and executory by operation of law, and the NLRC would be deprived of jurisdiction to entertain the appeal. Here are the requisites for perfecting an appeal. 1. The memorandum of appeal. 2. Payment of appeal fee. 3. Posting of appeal bond in case of an appeal by the employer. And 4. Proof of service of the appeal to the adverse party. A notice to appeal without complying with the requisites for perfection of an appeal does not stop the running of the period for perfecting an appeal. The memorandum of appeal should be verified by the appellant himself and should state the following. 1. The date when the appellant received the decision. 2. The grounds for the appeal. 3. The arguments in support of the appeal. And 4. The relief prayed for. There are certain aspects that will not be considered as jurisdictional defects if you're talking about the memorandum of appeal. 1. Failure to state the date when the appellant received the decision. This is not a jurisdictional defect. It is a mere procedural lapse that is addressed to the sound discretion of the National Labor Relations Commission. 2. Failure to put the memorandum of appeal under oath is also not a fatal defect. It is a condition that simply affects the form of the pleading. Such defect can easily be corrected by requiring an oath. If there's no allegation of fact, verification would even be useless and superfluous. A mere letter expressing disappointment over the judgment of the labor arbiter. Can this be considered as a memorandum of appeal? In one case, it was not considered as a memorandum of appeal because of its failure to comply with the statutory requirements. Appeal fee. The appeal fee is a requirement for perfection of the appeal. This should be paid within the reglementary period to appeal. Otherwise, the decision appealed from becomes final and executory as if no appeal was filed at all. Appeal bond. Only employers who appeal on a monetary award of the labor arbiter in his decision are required to post an appeal bond. When does the employer post the appeal bond? Within the reglementary period to appeal. Even if the memorandum of appeal was filed within the reglementary period, the appeal must be dismissed if the appeal bond was not posted within the period to appeal. how would you determine the amount of the appeal bond to be posted? Just remember here that damages and attorney's fees would be excluded in the computation of the appeal bond to be posted. In what form may the appeal bond be? This may be in cash or surety bond. Surety bond, this must be issued by a reputable bonding company duly accredited by the NLRC. The surety bond must be genuine. A fake or expired bond is, in legal contemplation, a mere scrap of paper. Hence, the submission of a fake or expired bond does not perfect the appeal. The surety bond must be valid. A surety bond issued by a blacklisted bonding company is not valid. Hence, this will not perfect the appeal. The subsequent lifting of the blacklist will not validate the bond. Question: can the employer ask or request that the appeal bond he will post be reduced? The answer is a yes, but note the requisites. 1. The employer must file a motion to reduce appeal bond within the reglementary period to appeal, citing a meritorious ground. And 2. The employer must post a provisional bond equivalent to at least 10% of the monetary award, exclusive of damages and attorney's fees. If the foregoing conditions are complied with, then the 10-day reglementary period to perfect the appeal will be suspended. If the NLRC denies the motion to reduce bond or requires an increase on the provisional bond, then the appellant shall be given a fresh period of 10 days from notice within which to perfect the appeal by posting the required appeal bond. In some cases, there have been examples of meritorious grounds for reduction of the appeal bond. 1. Lack of financial capacity to pay the full amount of the appeal bond, as evidenced by the audited financial statement, which shows a deficit in income plus the fact that the existence of employer-employee relationship is disputed. 2. Lack of employer-employee relationship. 3. When prescription has set in. On the other hand, there are scenarios which were not considered as meritorious grounds. 1. Substantial monetary award, even if it runs into millions, is not a meritorious ground for reduction of the appeal bond. 2. A monetary award that exceeds the authorized capital stock is also not a meritorious ground for the reduction of the appeal bond. This is because the employer company can post a surety bond, in which case it will have to pay only a moderate and reasonable amount for premium of such bond. Note that the appeal bond shall be valid and effective from the date of posting until the case is finally decided or the award satisfied. Note also the scenarios where an appeal bond is not required. 1. If the employee is the appellant. 2. If the appeal questions only the award of damages or attorney's fees. 3. If there's no monetary award. Or 4. If the decision does not state the amount of the monetary award. Proof of service. In all cases, the appellant should furnish the other party a copy of the memorandum of appeal together with the certified true copy of the surety bond. Failure of the appellant to furnish the adverse party with a copy of the memorandum of appeal is not a fatal defect, but a mere formal lapse. If there's no proof of service to the adverse party, the National Labor Relations Commission must inform the adverse party of the appeal to give him an opportunity to be heard. Otherwise, there would be a violation of due process. What's the remedy if a party wants to assail the decision of the National Labor Relations Commission? This is a motion for reconsideration. Unlike the decisions of the labor arbiter, decisions of the National Labor Relations Commission may be the subject of a motion for reconsideration. The filing of a motion for reconsideration is in fact a conditio sine qua non for the filing of a special civil action for certiorari. Only one motion for reconsideration of the same party shall be entertained. Question: can decisions of the National Labor Relations Commission be subject to judicial review? The answer is a yes, by means of a special civil action for certiorari, which may be filed not later than 60 days from notice of judgment, order, or resolution sought to be assailed. Where should this petition be filed? With the Court of Appeals. The special civil action for certiorari is not part or a continuation of the NLRC proceedings. In other words, the effect of certiorari proceedings is that it does not interrupt the course of a cause unless a writ of injunction is issued stopping it. Therefore, the mere filing of a petition for certiorari will not stay the execution of the NLRC decision unless a temporary restraining order is issued by the Court of Appeals. Without a temporary restraining order, the labor arbiter can validly issue a writ of execution. Suppose the judgment was already executed during the pendency of the certiorari proceedings, but the Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court reversed the judgment of the National Labor Relations Commission. What would be the remedy? A party should file a motion for restitution. The labor arbiter here shall order the employee to restitute the executed award, except the reinstatement salaries paid during the pendency of the appeal. Restitution comes as a necessary and inevitable consequence of the reversal of the judgment of the National Labor Relations Commission, and it is not necessary for the Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court to make an express order for restitution in their decision. So now go to the Secretary of the Department of Labor and Employment. Visitorial and Enforcement Power. Under Article 128, the Secretary of Labor and Employment or his duly authorized representatives are empowered to inspect establishments to determine whether employers are complying with labor standards. Violations that may be discovered during the inspection are carried out through a compliance order and writ of execution which the Secretary of Labor and Employment or his duly authorized representative may issue in the exercise of their enforcement power under Article 128B of the Labor Code. Under Article 128C, the Regional Director can order the suspension of operations of any unit or department of an establishment if a violation of safety rules poses grave and imminent danger to the health and safety of workers in the workplace. If the violation is attributable to the fault of the employer, then the employees concerned are entitled to their wages during the period of suspension of operations. Orders issued in the exercise of the visitorial power under Article 128 of the Labor Code of the Philippines are appealable to the Secretary of Labor and Employment within 10 calendar days from receipt of the order. The appeal will be perfected only upon the posting of a cash or surety bond issued by a reputable bonding company duly accredited by the Secretary of Labor and Employment in the amount equivalent to the award in the order appealed from. Unlike decisions of the labor arbiters that are appealed to the National Labor Relations Commission, reduction of appeal bond is not proper for orders or decisions of the regional director that are appealed to the Secretary of Labor and Employment. The reason is, reduction of bond in the National Labor Relations Commission is expressly authorized under the 2011 NLRC Rules of Procedure as amended. On the other hand, there is no similar authority given to the Secretary of Labor and Employment. In other words, the Secretary of Labor and Employment has no authority to accept an appeal under a reduced bond. Hence, if the appeal bond is insufficient, the appeal must be dismissed for non-perfection. Remember the essential features of the visitorial and enforcement power. 1. The visitorial and enforcement powers are exercisable over establishments and not over individual employees because what is sought to be achieved by its exercise is compliance with labor standards, laws, and regulations. 2. The visitorial and enforcement power is not restricted by the amount involved. Even if the amount involved is more than 5,000 pesos per employee, the visitorial and enforcement power can still be exercised. This is unlike the adjudicatory power under Article 129 of the Labor Code of the Philippines, which limits the jurisdictional amount to 5,000 pesos. 3. The entire employees who are still working with the said establishment will benefit therefrom, even if they did not sign the complaint or request for inspection. The enforcement power cannot be exercised under the following circumstances. 1. When the employer contests the findings of the inspectors. And 2. When the employer raises issues supported by documentary proofs which were not considered during inspection. Note the distinctions between the adjudicatory power and enforcement power. 1. As to basis, if we're referring to the adjudicatory power, this is based on a complaint filed by the employee. If we're referring to the enforcement power, this is based on the inspection results. 2. As to subject matter, regarding the adjudicatory power, this is exercisable only on pure money claims. As regards the enforcement power, this is exercisable not only on money claims, but also on violations of health and safety standards. 3. As to workers involved, as regards the adjudicatory power, this applies to employees who have already been separated from service and do not seek reinstatement. On the other hand, as to the enforcement power, this applies only to employees who are still in service. 4. As to the amount involved, adjudicatory power, this is exercisable only on money claims not exceeding 5,000 pesos. enforcement power. This is not limited by the amount involved. 5, as to appellate body. If you're talking about the adjudicatory power, orders are appealable to the National Labor Relations Commission. On the other hand, if you're talking about enforcement power, orders are appealable to the Secretary of Labor and Employment. 6, as to the period to appeal adjudicatory power, orders are appealable within 5 days from receipt. Enforcement power, orders are appealable within 10 calendar days from receipt. Prescription of offenses and claims. Note Article 305, offenses penalized under this code and the rules and regulations issued pursuant thereto shall prescribe in 3 years. Note the prescriptive period of a criminal action for illegal recruitment. Illegal recruitment of workers for local employment, this is 3 years under Article 305 of the Labor Code of the Philippines. How about illegal recruitment of overseas Filipino workers? If we're talking about simple illegal recruitment, it's 5 years. If we're talking about qualified illegal recruitment, that is syndicated or large scale, 20 years. How about prescription of unfair labor practice? If we're referring to the administrative aspect, it's 1 year from commission of the ULP. If we're referring to the criminal aspect, this is 1 year from the finality of the judgment in the administrative case. How about the prescriptive period for illegal dismissal? 1. If the complaint prays for reinstatement, prescriptive period is 4 years from the date of dismissal because the action is predicated upon an injury to the rights of the plaintiff, which under Article 1146 of the Civil Code of the Philippines must be brought within 4 years. The 4-year prescriptive period should be reckoned from the date the employee was illegally dismissed. The filing of a criminal case against the employee will not interrupt the running of the prescriptive period for filing the action for reinstatement because the right to file an action for illegal dismissal is not dependent upon the outcome of the criminal case. 2. If the complaint prays for separation pay only without reinstatement, then prescriptive period is 3 years from date of dismissal because this is a money claim. How about prescription of money claims? Go to Article 306. All money claims arising from employer-employee relations accruing during the effectivity of this code shall be filed within 3 years from the time the cause of action accrued. Otherwise, they shall be forever barred. Note the scope of money claims. Covers all money claims arising from employer-employee relationship, including those recoverable under a CBA, employment contract, or company policy. Note the appropriate entities having jurisdiction over money claims. 1. Money claims with prayer for reinstatement. This should be filed with the regional arbitration branches of the National Labor Relations Commission, regardless of the amount involved. 2. If there's no demand for reinstatement, if we're talking about a money claim not exceeding 5,000 pesos, this should be filed with the DOLE regional director. If we're talking about money claims exceeding 5,000 pesos, this should be filed with the regional arbitration branches of the National Labor Relations Commission. Money claims of OFWs, they should be filed with the regional arbitration branches of the NLRC. What's the reckoning date of the prescriptive period? 1. Should be from the day of the commission of the violation, if the commission is known. Or 2. From discovery of the violation in institution of judicial proceedings for its investigation and punishment, if the commission of the violation was not known at that time.